Super glad to see you here. And we thought we'd wait a couple minutes to see how many. I think it said I have 28 followers that are on Instagram. I don't know how this all works. So we just maybe we just dive in and go for it, Inger.
So there's something weird here. I can't see myself on the screen. Do you see my face?
I can see your whole face. Yep, you're
Okay,
good.
then we're
You're
good.
perfect.
I don't need to see myself as long as you can see me.
Yeah, you're good. So I'll just introduce myself. I'm Sarah Seidelman, and I am an author and shamanic healer, and I am 54 years old, and I didn't start running till I was 42. And Inger, tell
Yeah.
me, yeah.
Similar, like I am Inger Kenobi. I am a life coach and author, and I started like writing like for real, I think when I was, well, I suddenly made a plan that I needed to have my first book published by the time I was 40, and it was published the day before my 41st birthday. So yeah, I'm kind of like so-called late to the game as well.
I love it. And I just had a friend who last year published her first book at 75. So there is no such thing as too late or you're not meant to be a writer. So anyway, we were going to jump in and just share some of the things that have held us back in different moments from writing, and in particular writing books. And want to encourage you, like if you have questions you want to ask, maybe at the end we'll answer some of those questions, because we'd like to, yeah, we want to support you guys, who those of you who want to write a book, we that's what we're here for, is we want to support you.
I know,
So
because also people have so many different questions, and it's so interesting too just to hear what these like hang-ups are. And for other people, they might sound like, oh my God, that's ridiculous. But for us, when we have them, they feel very serious, and it feels like a real blockage to get over.
totally. Inger, do you want to jump in with what was one of the things that held you back from writing your book?
It's almost like embarrassing, but I think like from the get-go, I was under the impression, I grew up loving books, reading all the time. I learned to read by myself when I was like four or something, and I would read chapter books, and I just like read and read and read. But I never put two and two together that there was actually regular people writing these books. I thought it was some like exalted beings, like almost like Übermenschen or like super talented people or like Mozart's, like you were good from the get-go. So I always like saw myself as a reader of books, not a writer of books. And I tried to write and it just came out garbage. And I didn't know that this was something you could get better at. Like no one told me this. And or maybe they did, but it just never registered. So I just wrote it off as like, oh, I'm not good at this. And this is something you're good at from the beginning. Otherwise, it's not for you. So that was my first hurdle to overcome.
Yeah, I can so relate to that. A lot of us who are writers were voracious and are voracious readers. And I kind of, my issue with that is that for me, it was like I would compare and despair. So I would think, okay, I think of all my favorite books, like one of my favorite books from childhood, but even as an adult, I look at it as Charlotte's Web. And to me, that book is such a masterpiece. And it took E.B. White like something like 13 years to write that book. And I think, first of all, how does anybody take 13 years to do anything? Like, I doubt that I have the discipline to work on something like that. And I also, I know he wrote for the New Yorker. I mean, the guy was an established, famous, professional writer. So it's like when I think about my favorite writers, it make me feel worried that maybe I wasn't a real writer, because I just started to have the passion hit me at about age 42 to write a book. I'm now 54, and in that time, I've written six books.
That's
Now,
amazing, by the way, which is incredible. That's just fantastic.
well, thank you. It's been a lot of fun, and also challenging, because we have to get through these things. So if you just joined, Inger and I are both authors who published books, and we are just sharing like some of the things that held us back from writing books and how we kind of conquered that. And I would say my conquering basically came of that fear of being kind of an imposter or not being good enough. I connected, I reached out for connection. That was the thing. So I called somebody who I had heard helped people with organize their writing. And I reached out to her, and she was like, of course you can write a book. And I was like, you think I can? And it was really through that, like, we don't do these things alone. So for me, reaching out to somebody else, made all the difference.
Well, and say, like, similar for me, like I didn't reach out, but like a friend of mine, she teaches creative writing, and she was missing a few pieces to have her evening classes approved at the local college. So she said, Ingo, can you just join? Can you just like sit there and join my creative writing class? And we did so many fun writing exercises and so many fun things. And I'm like, oh, I didn't know this could be fun. I didn't know I had a voice. I didn't know I had something to say. So just kind of like accidentally being like called in and just going through these writing exercises and having fun with writing and getting like, you know, feedback and pointers. And I'm like, oh my God, there are pointers. There are way of improving this. There are like secrets of the trade that makes this better. And I just was like, that was a whole new world opened up to me. I mean, I knew creative writing classes existed, but again, I felt like it was only for special people. It wasn't for someone like me. It was only for serious writers. It was for people who had it as a calling since they were born. You know, I don't know where I got that, you know, narrative from, but it was there and it was really holding me back.
Yeah, totally. And Centered View is saying that's a big one for me, imposter syndrome. Absolutely. And I think that also kept me from investing in myself as a writer, like taking time off from work, because I'd be like, well, it's dumb to take time to work on my book or to pay somebody to look at my work to help me kind of fix it or repair it. Because I could be making money, and this may not be a money-making proposition, writing this book. And so therefore, like, there was this part of me that was like, you should not, this is a waste of money, like spending time on a writing retreat or like taking time off from work. I just felt that guilt. So that was another thing that held me back.
Yeah, the time piece, definitely. Like I could do something useful. I could be practical. There are stuff around the house that needs doing. Shouldn't I focus on a new degree instead of this like piddling around at a coffee house, just writing little novels that no one will see? Like, what does this amount to? This like the productivity voice kicked in, like the one that needs to be practical and useful and productive. It's like, if this is not amounting to anything, what are we doing here? You know?
Totally. Totally. Yeah. What do you have any other, you know, tell me, share another one that kind of something that held you back. Well, I've got more on my list too.
Oh my God. When I started thinking, I realized the list wasn't short. You know, it was kind of like, again, it's subconscious. I never sat down. I want to write. These are the things holding me back. It was just the stuff held me back and I didn't do it. And I think another one is that I don't have the kind of like Tolkien fantasy or Harry Potter. Like, I don't write fiction. I don't have this kind of mind that can create worlds and come up with stories, even detective stories. I love detective stories, but my mind doesn't go there. I like memoirs and people's lives and, you know, how-to books and, you know, all these things. And again, I thought in order to write a memoir or write from yourself, you had to be basically Nelson Mandela or done something amazing or climbed Mount Everest or had this amazing life that was like outwardly recognized as incredible from the get-go. But again, one of my the friend who was teaching this writing course, she gave us this homework to write this essay, like a how-to essay from our life based on, I brought it up, Laurie Moore's self-help book, where you like how to talk to your mother, how to become a writer, how to, so just take a, she said, like, just take one tiny section of your life and write it as a how-to essay,
like the things I had for that.
Yeah, something. And at the time, this might sound weird, but at the time I was dating a gay older man. So I wrote How to Date a Gay Older Man from a Girl's Perspective. And it was a lot of fun.
That's awesome. I love it. What you were saying, I just thought of something I was thinking of now. Oh, I know, the fiction piece, because you said, you know, you were thinking about, you didn't want to write fiction, but you were curious about that. And you realized, oh, or you thought you don't have this imaginative mind that some of these masterful people do. So I got the idea with my most recent book that I wanted to write a work of fiction. And I thought, well, I don't know how to write a story. Like, that's, again, that takes years. You must be an expert. You must be one of these special people that's born, hatched out of a cosmic egg only to write these special books. But it turns out there's a book on how to do this. And I found this marvelous book called like The Snowflake Method of Writing Fiction. And it was a way to build a story. And it's basically like a DIY, like how to build a story. And I just, a very simple book. It is not complex. Trust me, if it was, I would never be able to get through it. It had lots of illustrations. And that's really what helped me to form the bones of the story, because so there's whatever it is that you're afraid of that you don't know enough about, there is something out there for you. There's someone or a book or a blog or somewhere you will find the information that you need to finish your book or to get it started.
Oh, 100%. And also like this idea that, yeah, either you need to have this like have 20 years of your life to dedicate to this new project, or you need to like have like everything in order and you already have a book contract or you already know an agent. There's so many things that we think need to be in place first, instead of just like writing for the joy of writing. And like, I never had this like added pressure of like my writing needs to be political and serious and add a voice to the culture. Like, but I know people who have that, like, you know, if it's not adding to a, you know, something of use, like something useful and meaningful and in, you know, according with like whatever's going on with the world, then they're not allowed to write like a chick flick or just something for fun or a comedy because it's too lighthearted and who cares. And it's like, but if you want to write that, you know, if you want to just play with the writing, play with the writing.
Yeah, amen. And we need interesting, like unique books. I mean, I get so delighted when I pick up something that's unusual and not what I'm expecting. And yeah, humor in particular is pretty awesome. I think that gets to this question of like, I think one of the big fears I had was kind of this existential fear of like, what if nobody cares? I don't even know if I could voice that, but like, it's kind of like this fear. What if I write this book and it doesn't matter to anybody? And I think that for me got into this whole, like a lot of expectations of like, oh, I hope everybody like, you know, I want a lot of people to like it. Or, you know, the ego wants a lot of things, you know, it wants to be on top of the New York Times bestseller list, or it wants these things.
But it wants approval.
Yeah, it wants approval. But what your soul knows is that writing this book that you have is going to delight you in ways and help you out in ways that you can't even imagine right now. Like, I remember working on, when I was telling my own story in one of my books, sort of memoir writing, so just sharing memories from my own life. And it was such a profound and moving experience because, you know, I found myself just like weeping and reliving these experiences and completely like re-understanding my entire life trajectory in a whole new way through that process. And no, the book did not get on the New York Times bestseller list, but the feedback that I got and the special people that read it that are a part of my life, it meant so much to me. And telling that story really helped me to understand myself. And I think that's one of the greatest things we can do in our life to prepare ourselves for death. I've been studying a lot about like, how do you get ready to die? Not that any of us wish to die soon, but like we never know what that day is that we might die, right? And so to prepare for that is really to understand our lives and what we've been up to, what's been happening to us and for us. And anyway.
No, so. I think that is important. I mean, like, talk about what didn't help. And like, this is so funny, like how our mind sometimes is kind of similar, because one of the things that made me go for writing my first book and really, really like dive in and super commit was the fact that I wrote myself a eulogy from my life, how it was now. And then I wrote the like a eulogy from the perspective of like what I wanted to do with my life, like publish the book, move to the Cotswolds, all these things. And I'm like, well, which one of these two do I want to be true? You
know? Yeah. I just had a client yesterday who they remembered that in there, because they had also done this experience or thing of writing their own eulogy or their own obituary. And in her obituary, she had written that she had written these compassionate and loving letters to people. And it's like, wow, if that's something that you want to do, it's like, yeah, you don't want to avoid that till it's too late, right? That today's the day.
And that brings us to another, I think another hurdle. Like once you get, you warm up to the idea, yeah, maybe I can write this and maybe my story will be useful, if not for anyone else, at least myself. Then there is that added like stressor of finding the perfect time to start.
Yes.
The perfect moment. Like there needs to be this like, you know, fall turns into winter and like, or like regular life turns into author life, but it doesn't really happen like that. You just actually start.
Yeah. Pick a day and claim that day, like decide this is what's going to happen.
Line in the sand, jump over, do some kind of weird ritual, clear a space, just like because you can start. This is the fun thing, right? You don't have to wait until the semester opens or until the stock market, you know, closes for the day or anything like external. You can just decide for yourself. Today at 5, I will open up a Word document and start my book. That's it.
That's how I began my very first book. I opened a document one day and I just wrote like 5 things on it. The title kept coming to me. What I thought the title was is sometimes, you know, your book title, maybe some of you who are listening to this, you already have your book title or what you think it is. Open a file and like just blurt your ideas out. It doesn't matter if they're good or bad, just put them down and then, you know, spend 15 minutes. And then close it for the day.
Yes.
If you did that 15 minutes every day for a year, it would blow your mind what would happen.
And also you get used to the idea, if not for nothing else, you get used to the idea, I'm a person who writes. I'm a person who has a writing spot in my house. I'm a person with a Word document that could become a book. And then if you show up for yourself in that way, then like without having to add on any type of motivation or affirmations or anything special, suddenly part of your identity is that, oh my God, I'm a writer. It kind of like sneaks in there and it's kind of a fabulous feeling.
It is. And to let people know you're working on something. I mean, maybe you want to keep it secret from certain people because we always encourage people to create like a really safe space, especially if you're feeling vulnerable. And sometimes writing a book can feel pretty vulnerable, especially if you're writing about vulnerable topics, you know?
Yeah.
Agreed. I was going to say another thing that really stopped me, and this is kind of maybe along the same lines of something we talked about before, but I remember one time when I was working on, it wasn't even my first book. So this is a great story of even once you've written one book, and when I finished my first book, I was like, whoo, that was hard. And like, I'm super excited and it got some good reception and it was fun. And then the woman who helped me do all the editing at the end, she said, well, what are you going to write for your next book? And I was like, you think I can write another book? She's like, oh, yeah. And I was so excited about this idea. And I was like, wow, what would I write? And then, you know, all the ideas started to bubble. But I remember in that time, I happened to visit like a Barnes & Noble.
Mm.
And I walked in and, you know, there's just acres and acres of brilliant books in there. And it was weird. It was like this feeling of like, look at all these brilliant books. They have the stacks of like the classics and then the stacks of like the most popular books that, you know, millions of people have reviewed and think are wonderful. And I was just like, by the end of my day, I was like, I just have no desire to like even try. It was just like, so if you're in that place, just remind yourself that every book that's ever been written, somebody had to start somewhere. And that even if there's been like 20 books written on the topic of, say, how to deal with ADHD, one of my favorite topics, and I'm thinking about working on a book on that. Whatever it is that you're drawn to writing about, even if there's a million books on it, only you can write the book that you can write that's going to be such a unique and special look at this. And so just remember that, like, you're one of a kind, you're one in a million. And I kind of think of it too, like, it's our duty to let that uniqueness come out in the world because somebody needs to hear what you have to say.
Oh, I think that is so true. And I think it's so interesting, like, we're hearing when Elizabeth Gilbert talking about her book tour after Eat, Pray, Love, and she met so many angry women who said, you wrote my book. You stole my book idea. And she was like, no, I didn't. I wrote mine. You know, like, feel free to write yours. But we get the sense of like, shit, someone took my idea. Like, if you've been sitting on an idea for so long, like a long time, and someone else publishes on the topic, you feel like, oh God, I lost my chance. Well, you didn't, but you could have written it sooner. That's a good indication if you get mad and resentful.
Yeah, when we get mad or we get jealous of somebody else, that I always think is a wonderful sign that it's really time for us. Like, our soul's like, come on.
Come on.
It's getting us out of the nest. Like, it's time to get on this project. And we have a wonderful class that we are offering in January. And it's sort of like a mini class / experience / group power force thing, and we're going to all simultaneously write our books starting January 13th. And there's a lot of social science behind the idea that when we do things together and we begin in a very powerful manner, we tend to be much more successful than when we try to go it alone. And yes. So we're really excited about it. And you don't need to know exactly what your book topic is or exactly what you're writing about. All you need to know is that you have this heart's desire to write this book. And I feel like the once we claim that we're going to do it, it's like opening a door, you know, like the universe starts to just deliver information, people, resources, like all the things that we need.
And also once you stop spending so much energy on why you couldn't and why it's not the right time and why you're not the right person, once you release all those thoughts because you're actually doing it, then all that space and energy and thought process now can just like clears the space for what is helpful to come in instead. Because it's not like that goes away and then nothing. It's like, then you have conversations, then you discover, oh my God, anyone can write self-help. Anyone can write on any topic. It doesn't even have to be useful. You know, it's like, and you have conversation, ideas, resources, everything from like how to structure a novel to what is the best writing program. And we're not just talking about inspiration, but like real writing tools. And you don't see them when you're super busy talking yourself out of doing it.
Yeah. And that's really our main message, is that if you want to write a book, you can. And it's just a matter of sitting down and not letting the fact that you don't have 20,000 followers on Instagram. Inger had the funniest line of all a month back. She's like, what if Charles Dickens had been like, dang, I got to get my Instagram following up before I even attempt to write a book? I mean, we wouldn't have A Tale of Two Cities or the Christmas Carol. I mean, it would be a tragedy. But yet that is what's keeping a lot of people right now from writing, is saying like, I don't have enough social clout. But it's like, that's not true. When I wrote my first book, I had zero followers on Instagram because Instagram didn't exist. And I don't know, I think I had like maybe 500 people or something, but you don't have to have anybody to follow you.
No, and I mean, it's like, here's the funny thing. I didn't even have like a traditional publisher. I started my own publishing company, had zero Instagram follower. And yet somehow I ended up on like BBC Radio, and I did a little local book signing, and I was in the Scottish, you know, I was in a cover of like a woman's magazine here in Scotland. And it's like, so it's like, they don't care. Like the following, like if someone is concerned about that, Instagram followers is not a barometer of how successful you will be as a writer. Like, can we just like state that for once and for all? Because having yes. to think that you need to be famous for your book before you have your book, or you need to be and have more followers to get readers, like those two don't add up. It has nothing to do with each other.
No, and in fact, what's weird is, like, I wrote my first book, which is called What the Walrus Knows. It's out of print. But really, I had no idea what I was doing. And I was just writing this book because I had all the passion in the world to write it. I just loved the topic and I was so pumped about it. And really what that did was strange. It's like people, I became more established in what I was doing. People took me very seriously because I had written a book, which I thought was really funny, because I'm like, well, you could write a book too. But I mean, you know, it's just deciding to commit some time to put some resources towards this dream of yours is very powerful. And sometimes it works the other way around. You write your book and that helps you to connect. And I mean, my books have helped lots of people, and that sets me free and makes me so happy because I feel like I've been useful. And I think ultimately, isn't that most of us writers want to be useful? We want to entertain, or we want to teach something.
And I also think that like once you get this idea like sort of like out of the way, then you're not you don't have this like creative bottleneck, because you never got the first poem out or the first book out or the first whatever out, like, and that clears the way, clears the path for new ideas. And like, I thought I would only write one book, and now I have like five new book ideas. I need to clone myself to get going, you know. But but it's like, that's another fear. If like, I'll use it all in the first book and I'll never be inspired again. I'll use up all my energy in the first book and I'll never have that time again. Like, I can't set so much time away, like aside each single time. And there's this weird scarcity thing. But like, once you get going, fine if you write one book, fine if you write 10, but don't let the fear of the future books stop you from writing the first book, because that's just ridiculous.
And the time thing, like, I think we've talked, Inger and I've talked about how we believed at one point, like, well, I need to, like, quit my job completely, or I need to, like, go on a 6 months retreat, or I need to, like, squirrel myself away for, like, 3 weeks to get this book written. Well, that is one way to get a book written, I'm sure, and probably some people have done that. But the other way is also just blocking off, you know, an hour here, 3 hours there. You know, maybe at some point you realize, wow, I've got enough stuff here. I need to kind of sit with it. And then I've, yeah, gone away for a weekend and you know, had some space to, like, lay all the papers out and try to organize it. But you don't need to quit your job. You don't need to.
Oh, and if you figure out that you need that later, fine. But don't think that you need to quit first and then, you know, like there's a recipe here. Like, there is no recipe, there is no blueprint, there is no cookie cutter way of doing it. Like, there's only your way of doing it. So my way wouldn't work for other people, and your way wouldn't work for other people, because, like, we all have our own unique writing path. And that's why I think, like, compare and despair. And, like, what's interesting about, like, joining a group is that you would think that we would compare in a group, but what happens in a group setting, of course, is that we support each other and we inspire each other and we encourage each other's, like, uniqueness and qualities and skills and talent and experiences. So everything gets amplified in the most positive way. And I love that of the group dynamic. It's so powerful.
It is. And we are not in this group, we're going to be supporting each other, but we are not going to be reading each other's material. We are not going to be asking you to share your material unless you want to work with somebody else, like you want to partner with somebody. But that is not part of the group requirement. The group requirement is just that we're going to show up, we're going to do our commitments, and we're going to, you know, post in the group and share what we're up to. And Inger and I will be supporting you through that. And if you want to check out the details and learn more, and there's a free 90-minute writing class on the page, you can head right to my my profile. In the link in my profile, it says Fly Together, and there's a free class there. Yeah. And I don't know if anybody had any questions about writing a book, but if you do, like, let's post it, because we're sort of towards the end. I think we were going to make this 30 minutes to not make it too long. So if somebody has a question, we would love to, we're here to support you in your writing of your book. And we have this class coming up January 13th that we're going to be, it's really less of a class, more of a, you know, a group effort to write together this.
I think of it as like this, like, wild experiment, because what it is that we're just focusing on the writing. You don't have to be good. You don't have, like you said, you don't have to share. You don't have to worry about, like, the publicist and the marketing and the insert. Like, we're, like, removing all that fluff and all that's, like, all the other stuff, like, shove it aside. Focus on the writing, getting the words down on the page. And after you're done, then you can pursue all the other things, but the real work is the writing. So that's what we want to focus on.
Amen. And Sarah's asking, how did you know you were meant to write a book? Like, what was the feeling or inner knowing that told you to write? Great question. For me, here's what happened to me. At the time, I had left my medical practice. I was really interested in animal totems and the messages of wild animals coming and what they meant. And as I explored the available books on the market, a lot of them were kind of scary or ominous or had weirdness to them. And I was like, after I worked with it and it started helping me, I was like, people need, like, a really sweet, gentle, playful book. I mean, this is powerful work and it can be quite serious, but I feel like I wanted to create a book. It was like, I wrote the book that I felt like I wanted to find, but could not find. So that was, for me, my big insight. So that's, I just had this passion, like, I wanted to fill this niche and I wanted to reach a helping hand out to the people that were feeling lost and confused. Like I had once been feeling, I mean, I still do on a given basis, but you know what I mean? Like, in general, how about you, Inger? How did you know you wanted to write a book?
Well, it was that weird resentment thing. I picked up a book that was like so easy, so straightforward, so to the point of, like, and it wasn't literary, it wasn't anything. It was like a how-to book around sewing. And I was like, God damn it, I could have written this. And I got mad and I wrote to the publishing company like, and just said, well, I have another idea. I read this book. I was kind of mad as I wrote the email. I have this other book idea. What do you think? And they're like, we love that idea. Can you send us a synopsis? And I was like, shit, the journey has begun.
I love it.
So it's out of rage and jealousy and frustration with myself. Like, why am I not starting? What the hell am I waiting for?
Yeah. And somebody's asking, does it matter if we don't have an outline already? You do not need an outline already. That is exactly what you are going to, as when we start on January 13th, like that might be your first self-assignment to yourself is like, what do I do with an outline? Maybe just starting to throw random ideas again into a Google Doc where you're like, I don't know how the outline's going to go, but here's the things I know that I want to be in there. And then just continuing to brainstorm, like keeping it on your phone, because once you start to work on that outline, Ashley Adwater. Once you start working on that outline, more ideas will start to flood you. Like the universe will just be like, bing, 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 or it might not be that fast. Hopefully slowly.
No, but it does come fast too. So I will say, yes, once you start, like have your phone with you and you can like talk to yourself on the voice recorder. On the phone and get ideas down if you can't write. I just feel like, and of course in the class, we will share ideas. This is one type of outline. This is how I did it. This is another resource. We'll share resources. We'll talk about different ways of doing it because again, there's not one right way, but we will like, here are some options. And then you can pick to see which one of course fits for you, but we're not gonna tell you, you need to do this structure in this particular way, but there are ideas to get the, you know, outline juices flowing for sure.
And some people write with an outline, Ashley, and some people don't. They do what's called pantsing, like by the seat of your pants writing. Because what happens as you start, if you don't have an outline, if you start to write just what you kind of think sort of should maybe be in there, what will happen is naturally and organically, like an outline will come out of that. But if you're the kind of person who likes an outline, awesome. And one of the things I was going to talk about is one thing that kept me overwhelmed and kind of from taking action on my first book was I felt overwhelmed with all my ideas. So what helped me was to sit down with somebody and express kind of what I wanted the book to be about. And then she helped me to, because I'm ADHD, I'm like a explosion of ideas, but I'm not super good at like setting up systems. So if you can find a systemic sort of thinker, an organized thinker, she helped me to go, well, why couldn't you write like a couple chapters about introducing this? And then you could just do a page for each animal in this book. And then we talked about how, and that helped me so much. Cause once I had the outline, I was like way off to the races.
Yeah. And so I think that's true. I think that's true too. You start going and then like, once you get it all out there, you realize, oh, it's a little bit of a mess or how can I move things around? So everything is a work in progress, but there's nothing to work with unless you get it down on the page first. So if not having an outline is stopping you, just start writing. And then once you have the outline, you start to put the right pieces in the right places. And now you have the bones and you can fill it in, which will be like, yeah, people work differently. Sometimes the outline is like a godsend and sometimes it's an obstacle because the work doesn't want to come out in such a structured way from the get-go.
Absolutely. Yeah. So fun. Well, you guys, thank you all so much for being here. And you can go to the link in my profile and go to Fly Together. And on there is a free 90-minute course that we taught to help you connect with your book, to help you get some practical tools, to help you get writing. And then we hope that you will join us in January. If you'd like some support and you'd like to like harness the power of working in a group, because it is powerful. There's something about it. It's magical. So we hope you join us. And thanks for being here.
Thank you for being here, everyone. Thank you, Sarah.
Thanks, Inger. Mwah! Bye, everyone.